Well, welcome to New Hope. If you're a visitor this morning, please accept our welcome and fill out a card if you would like in front of you, and we will send you some information in the mail about what we do beyond here on Sunday mornings. There's a lot of activities that go on throughout the week at this church, so we would like to give you information on what we do in those circumstances. It's not just Sunday mornings. Give you an update. Tim and the team in 1040i, they're doing well. Everything's going well. They're ahead of schedule. The surgeries are ahead of schedule. This construction is ahead of schedule. They finished the first Kids Fest at the Neonan Village, which is the one that we sponsor. They're moving on to another village called Nikolai next week, so they'll be doing another Kids Fest there for a week. And a lot of the women that are in our team are involved in that. The weather apparently is mild, which is good, so they're not under extreme heat like they've had in the previous years. Tim participated in a pastor's workshop for Ivorian pastors over the last few days. That finished yesterday. And he basically said that they're looking for prayers just in general, but also specifically for health. Because apparently three members of the 1040 team, he didn't specify it was any of ours, but have come down with malaria-type symptoms. So prayers for their quick recovery would be very welcome so that they can get back on their feet and keep doing what they need to be doing. Also, Tim said he has gout in his foot that has come back. So prayers for him. You know, he's part of his job is to move patients from surgery into the post-op. So he needs to be able to do that efficiently. So hopefully he'll recover from that quickly. But he said everyone's in good spirits and things are going well over there. Other announcements. Men's Thursday morning Bible study started last week, but it was just a video, so that's on Right Now Video. It's called Watch Your Mouth by Tony Evans. So if you want to catch up with that, there's a video on Right Now. If you don't have access to Right Now Media, Teddy or Corey will be able to help you with that so that you can watch those videos. But it's not too late to join this coming Thursday, 6 a.m. in the office. Speaking of men's activities, NB2 Racing yesterday, a handful of guys from New Hope went over to NB2 Racing to try their hand at basically showing up the other one. It looks Scott Hammock was by far and away the very convincing winner of the racing, all three heats. So he really put a stamp of authority onto that. So well done, Scott. We're sorry we don't have a prizes or anything, but bragging rights is probably enough. Right, yeah. There you go. So my whole theory about you have to be young to win that is completely gone out of the window. No, you're welcome. Anytime. There is a meeting after the services today in the bridge for the Mexico mission trip. If anyone's interested in the Mexico mission trip, then that's today at 12:30 in the bridge. If you're interested in going yourself or you have kids that are interested in going, go along and get some information about that after services. Speaking of youth, Chris is going to talk about the 30-hour famine now.
Awesome, thanks. Good morning, everybody. How are you? Awesome. Hey, so I'm excited to talk to you guys a little bit about what we're doing in the student ministries department. In the student ministries department, we have a desire to see our students passionately digging into their faith, getting excited about growing God's family, and being pumped about pursuing God's focus. And God's focus, as we see in the New Testament, is widows and orphans and people, right? And so did you guys know that over 7,000 people a day are dying due to hunger-related causes or malnutrition or something to deal with food? 7,000 people a day. Us in the student ministries department, part of wanting to get our kids pumped about pursuing God's focus is we want to raise awareness and raise money to help support that cause. $40 a day does a lot. It feeds them, it helps get some clothes, it helps them give them the basics that they need. $40 a month, it's not day, $40 a month, that's a lot easier. I did that in that service too, man. That's why no one responded to that, look out. $40 a month does that. And so I just wanted to come and let you guys know what we're doing Just so you can be doing a few things, and we would like your help with a few things. The first one, and I think the most important, is prayer. We need your prayers, we need your prayers, we need your prayers. Our students are teenagers, right, for the most part, and they already have a lot of things going on. And then add, once we get to about hour 25 of not eating for 30 hours, there could be some interesting things that happen, right? And so part of what we're doing is it's a 30-hour famine. We are fasting for 30 hours. We are not eating any food for 30 hours because there's people who go on maybe a meal a day, maybe a meal a day. And so we need your prayers. We need your prayers. The second thing that we would love, if you would like to donate towards this, part of that $40, heck, if you want to do $40 a day, that's cool. $40 a month, if you wanted to donate something, anything would help. Just in the memo lining of your check, just put 30-hour famine. We'll make sure that gets to the right place. And again, I just want to land with, we need your prayers. We need your prayers. The people overseas need your prayers. The numbers have been going down, which is very cool to see. But I'm really excited about what God's going to do in our students. And so part of those prayers, aim at our students and just be asking that God reveal and make himself known in this 30 hours that we get to do this. So thank you guys so much. I'm excited to see and report back to you guys what happens in the lives of our students. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Chris. So the Primetimers Luncheon is coming up this Tuesday. If you are 55 plus and are interested in going to the Primetimers Luncheon, there will be two local gardening experts. When I say local, I mean from our church. Floyd and John Realhorn will be talking about what you could do this summer to use all this water that we've been getting and to make something out of that in your garden. So that'll be this Tuesday in the Bridge. We have a sign-up sheet going around, if you don't mind, Corey. Couple of clipboards going around that will be about financial peace. The Financial Peace University is Dave Ramsey's course. We've done it a few times here at the church. The first year that we did it, we got 52 people enrolled in it, which was great. So it's an excellent program. It is about financial management and budgeting for your personal finances, about how to do that in the most biblical way, also how to deal with any debt that you have in your life and how to plan for the future. So if you're interested in financial peace, we do not have a date set yet, but we're working on that. As soon as we get everybody signed up, then we'll contact everybody, figure out the best time to start, and also the best time of the week to have that meeting. So financial peace, well worth it if you are interested in improving your financial situation. Baptism, again, if you're interested in baptism, write it on a card, put it in the offering, or call the office. Get your name on the list. Should be coming up pretty soon. Again, we haven't got a date for that yet, but we're working on it. It'll be early spring. And then the Women's Spring Craft Event. Maureen, there you are. She's going to talk about succulent terrariums. This is not something that I say very often, so.
On Saturday, February the 25th, we're going to be having a ladies' luncheon and craft day. It's $15 to attend. And our craft for the day is going to be a succulent terrarium. And for all the ladies who are like me, who kill all of your plants, this is the perfect thing to do because they require very little water. And we'll have a good time. I'll be selling tickets for it outside in the pavilion after the service.
Thanks, Maureen. Women's retreat. So looking ahead a little bit, April 28th through the 30th, the women's retreat will be at Calvin Crest, the annual retreat. So there'll be more information about that coming down the road. But if you want to put that on your calendar, so that's April 28th through the 30th. And Widow's Lunch Bunch will be next Sunday after services at the Corner Bakery Cafe. And that'll be followed by a concert by the Clovis Community Band at Clovis North High School. So if you're interested in Widow's Lunch Bunch, it is next Sunday at 12:30. City Fest. We're going to watch a video about City Fest in a minute. Again, a quick update. City Fest is April 1st, 2nd. It is an evangelistic event by Luis Palau here in Fresno and to cover the Fresno Clovis area as well as surrounding towns and also the prisons. So well worth attending and thinking about who it is that you can us to attend to this event, and we're going to watch a quick video on CityFest.
There's a story being told throughout our nation that the church is no longer relevant, that religion is dead. But God tells a different story. When the church unites around Jesus to love their city, to make him known, he moves. Lives are changed. The story is rewritten. It's time for our friends, our family, our region, for the entire valley to experience Jesus. It's time for us to come together as one body, praying for our friends, serving our city, proclaiming the gospel. It's time for Good News in the Valley.
So that's an event that's going to be held around the Save Mart Center in the land and the parking lot surrounding Save Mart Center. It's a really good evangelistic opportunity. If you have people that you've been praying for, to hear the good news of people that you really want to just invite to something other than a Sunday morning service, this is going to be a good opportunity to do that. We have yard signs and we have other things like tickets that you can give out. It's not a ticketed event, but you can give out tickets as an opportunity just to invite somebody and put something in their hands so they can see the date and the times. So it'll be well worth doing if you really feel it on your heart that there's somebody that you want to invite to an event like that. And it'll be a lot of worship and prayer, a lot of speakers, including Luis Palau. So just keep that in mind as you pray for people, your neighbors, your friends, co-workers, for that opportunity. Getting prayer requests. Prayer requests for Tim Belcher and his family. His mom went home to be with the Lord this week on Friday morning after a fight with cancer and finally kidney failure. She lived in Modesto, so they're up there right now, and they will be for a few days. So keep them in prayer as they prepare for her memorial. But, you know, I think she wanted to die at home, so that was a wish that she had, and Tim took care of that through hospice, so that was he was able to do that for her. Barbara told me that she was very ready to meet Jesus, so she's in a great place this morning, better than any of us, so. Also, prayers for the family of John Belknap. He used to come to New Hope before he moved out of the area. He had a heart attack the week before last at the age of 63 and passed away. His wife, Cindy, I saw her yesterday at the memorial service, obviously very distraught. These sudden things like that are very, very difficult to deal with, and the family is coping with that. But prayers for them. It was a great service yesterday. Gene Sperling preached there. It was good to hear Gene preach again, so just keep them in your prayers. Donnie Enix, or Enix, I can never remember which one, I think he's 12 or 13, he's been battling low platelet count in his blood, and so the week before last he had some tests, he was at 13, and he should be at 150, it's 150,000 or 13,000, he should be at least 150,000 count, and he was down at 13,000. Well, this week it dropped to 7, so he went to the hospital, Children's Hospital, had transfusion there. Oh, dropped to 4, okay, even lower. So just keep them in your prayers. He's very fortunate. His parents, you know, very strong, their faith is very strong, and it's a good support system for him. Steve went to see him, seemed in good spirits, so we just keep them in prayer as they try and figure out what it is that's causing this drop all the time. Prayers for Polly Good. She was out of the hospital briefly this week and then back in again, so keep her in prayers. Cecil Spurlock's sister-in-law, or Kay's sister, was just keep her in prayer. She's in need with health issues, dementia issues. Plus, we have various people recovering from surgery this week, and then Robin Hustler, Mark Mims, Sharon Baker, all going through chemotherapy, radiation therapy, so keep them in prayer and just pray that the results that they are seeing are much better than they've seen in recent times. Okay, I'm gonna ask our ushers to come forward for our morning tithes and offerings. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're grateful for this day. We're thankful for a beautiful day this morning and some more rain this week, and as you shower down a bounty of rain this winter, we just pray for preparations to be able to receive it. Sometimes we, as you give us gifts, we're unprepared, and consequently up in the mountains we've been having so many problems with properties and things up there. We pray for the families that are affected by fast running water and floods up in the mountains, and we just pray that they stay safe from all that. We're just thankful for the opportunity to be able to worship openly in this country, you know, versus other countries where it's just too difficult or too dangerous to do. And we do worship you, and we just see all that is great in you, Lord. This morning we pray for the Belchers and the Belknap family as they cope with loss, and we just pray that they will find strength through you. We lift up Donnie to you as he goes through this bloodborne problems, and we just pray that there will be solutions found by the medical professionals. So be with them as they look into all these different issues. We pray for the 1040 team for health. We just pray that those that are suffering from these symptoms that could be malaria, that it's not, and that potentially it's just a short-term quick fix, so they can be back on their feet. And we just pray as they continue to do your work, and we're thankful that we can be part of this as a church. We pray for Corrie this morning as she delivers the message. We are excited to hear what she has to say to us, and we pray for open minds and open hearts to hear her message this morning. We pray for those that are mentioned, but also those that are not, those that are in the hearts of people here that we've not mentioned by name. We pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
So good morning, and as you know, Valentine's Day is near. I'm not sure how you would have missed this, because Target started decorating like December 23rd, right? So at first I thought, I should tell a little bit about Saint Valentine. But there's really not much to tell, and it's certainly not a story with chocolates, roses, and cupids, right? Saint Valentine was martyred on February 14th. He was killed for sharing the gospel and secretly marrying young lovers, that's fairly romantic, right? Marrying young lovers because the king had outlawed marriage because he needed more men to be willing to go to war. I decided not to talk about romantic love or marriage anyway, so we'll forget about Saint Valentine. But love, like how Jesus says we are to love one another. And I want to explore this morning how Jesus demonstrates his love. I would say he demonstrates his love with compassion. He died while we were yet sinners. He spent time with the least of society. With companionship, he called the 12 to himself and was with them. He touched and healed the sick. He held and blessed the children. He ate in people's homes. And with commitment, he repeatedly promises to come back. He promises the presence of the Holy Spirit after his death and resurrection, and plans for the future, and speaks to us about eternity with him. He is clear about unconditional love for us. The examples overlap, as they should, right? Compassion should bring some companionship. Companionship should have an element of commitment and follow through. Because you can have compassion for someone and not really do anything about it, but it doesn't really do much for the person you have compassion for, typically. There are times, of course, you can demonstrate compassion and say, I'm so sorry you're going through that, I can't imagine what it's like. And that is sincere love, and it's accepted as sincere love. But typically there is some overlap with compassion, companionship, and commitment. They usually go together. While preparing for today, I came across a video that I'm going to share. It's a spoken word by Amina Brown. Tim always talks about how he wishes he could sing, and then he'd just like break into song during sermons, and then he'd be like out of control. But if I could do spoken word like this woman, you probably wouldn't be able to shut me up. So just know in advance that this is what I meant to say, okay? So this is what I meant to say. This is He Is Here by Amina Brown.
He is here. right here in this room, in your heart. He is near, nearer than breath, heartbeat, nearer than you are to you, closer than second chance or next opportunity, closer than tonight or yesterday. He is real, realer than touch, see, hear, smell, or taste, realer than reality. He is our reality. He is present, like space, wind, time, silence, night. He is waiting, like creation, like words on the tip of tongue, like songs that have yet to be sung. He is beauty, oranges, blues, every hue, every shade, sunset and sunrise, whisper his name. He is holy, different, cannot be touched, explained, like sweet seconds of prayer, like grandmother on knees, wood floor bare. He is old hymns. He is the extending of limbs, stretched across trees, stripes to heal disease. He is sun, distinctly three, distinctly one, the only wise, the only resurrector of lives. He is king. No earthly throne can house, no amount of elegant words can espouse. He is moment and voice, power of choice, in word and deed, in fruit and seed, nailed hands, nailed feet, innocent wounds that bleed. He is believe and trust. He is enough. He is all. He is call and purpose. Everything that we can sacrifice, he's worth it and more, much more. Our good deeds are mere pennies. We'll never even the score. He is behold and wow. He is who, what, when. When, why, how. He puts on the show. He's the one we come to see. He is soul's cry and sinner's plea. He is the epitome. He is the one no one can light a candle to or come within a million foot pole of. He is above. He is a father's love. He is maker of ways, ancient of days. Has no fear. Have no fear. God is here.
Amen, right? That's what I meant to say, okay? I'm currently reading The Five Love Languages of Children. I'm really not committed to talking about marriage this morning. I'm reading The Five Love Languages of Children. It came after The Five Love Languages talking about marriage and romance, but this is about showing love to your children in a way that they can experience it and understand it through the understanding of the five languages of love. And it's the same ones that are in the marriage and romance one, which are words of affirmation, quality time, physical touch, receiving gifts, and acts of service are five ways that we can receive and understand love. So I took the little quiz in the back, and according to the quiz, my love language is words of affirmation and quality time on that day when I took that quiz, right? Like, isn't that how that works? My love language is words of affirmation. Thank you for this beautiful card. But today it's gifts, so where's the beautiful gift? Just kidding. So words of affirmation and quality time. And I thought, if we're called children of God, right? We're the children of God. I was wondering if God loves us in our love language, if that's a thing. And so I started thinking, okay, if words of affirmation and quality time represent how I receive love, I would say that yes, God does show me his love with my love language, and therefore I experience his love. I love the Bible. It assures me of his truth. It encourages me. I love worship music, and it comforts me and brings me joy. And those are all like words of affirmation, encouraging me and cheering me on, reminding me of his love, reminding me about the truths that I need to hear. And I love church. I love church things and church people, right? I experience his presence at church in space with you all. I pray conversationally with God most of the day. I experience his presence in prayer and by answered prayer. So I would say that's quality time. I know his presence. I know he's with me. So if he does speak to us in our love languages, then we may recognize that he doesn't speak to everybody the same way. And that's okay, and not something to be envied or judgment of how one receives the understanding of Jesus' love. I'm not really going to work through the love languages this morning. I'm going to narrow it to those three I said earlier, compassion, companionship, and commitment. If you want to join me in reading 1 John chapter 4, starting in verse 7. 1 John chapter 4, starting in verse 7, tells us about God's love. 1 John chapter 4, starting in verse 7. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. Amen. Compassion. We see clearly his compassion for us. He loved us while we were sinners and died for us without us doing anything for him, because he wants to spend eternity with us. We see his compassion when he goes to be with Mary and Martha after their brother Lazarus has died. And they tell him, in John, this is in John 11, they tell him, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. And then in John 11:33, it says, when he saw her, Mary, weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. Jesus wept. Our hurt is not missed or ignored. Even though Jesus knows the end, he knows the timeline, and this case knows that he's about to rise Lazarus from the dead, he still weeps with them because he has compassion for their grief. John chapter 8 shows us his mercy and gentleness when the teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought a woman caught in adultery before him and tell Jesus, in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now what do you say? And he didn't say much, right? He said, if any one of you is without sin, let him be the first to throw a stone. And so they walked away. She must have been standing there in a combination of terrified, angry, humiliated. But Jesus stood in the gap for her. He didn't condone her sin, but he without a doubt demonstrated a lesson on whether or not we should be pointing fingers or showing compassion. He showed us what it means to lead with love. And companionship. He traveled with the 12 and showed the disciples what love looked like. He went to the least of these and touched and healed them, ate with them, fed them, spoke truth to them. He was humble. He demonstrated how we are to serve one another when he washed Jesus's feet, and when he washed the disciples' feet. So John 13, if you want to, in John 13, this is where we see Jesus washing the disciples' feet. So in John 13, they're preparing to eat. And verse 3 says, Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. That's a pretty amazing thing to realize while you're sitting there preparing to eat. All power has been given to me. Everything is under my power. I'm from God and I'm going to return to God. That's a pretty amazing thought. And the next verse, verse 4 says, So he has a thought, and this thought creates a reaction or an action, right? I realize all power of the Father is in my hands. So what does he do? So verse 4, he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet. He isn't sitting there knowing that the Father has put all things under his power and looking at them thinking, what is it with these people? They have seen miracles, and yet they doubt. It's like they don't pay attention because they're always confused. I've provided everything they need, and yet they can be so ungrateful. No, that's not what he's doing when he realizes he has the power of God. Instead, he serves them. He behaves as a servant and washes their feet. And why does he do that? He tells them in verse 13, chapter 13, verse 13. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. So in other words, I know that I have been saved by grace, that my sin is washed away by the blood of Jesus, and that he has gone to make a place for me in heaven and called me a child of God and given me the power of the Holy Spirit so I can go wash others' feet, so I can serve. John 13, verse 34 and 35, a new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Jesus shows us that he is with us in the good and the bad and the sad and the lonely and in the stinky feet times. He's with us. And that leads to commitment. John 14, verses 1 through 4. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. This is Jesus talking. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going. This shows us that he wants to make plans with us. He's committed to a future with us. And he also assures us that he's told us the truth and what we need to know. He confirms, you know the way to the place where I'm going. We can question and make things more complicated all we want, right? But Jesus very clearly said that he is the way to the Father, that he was choosing to give his life as an atonement for our sin, and that he had the power to rise again to gift us the Holy Spirit and eternal life with him. Jesus' resurrection was proof that there was more. There was eternal life. He could have risen and left an empty tomb as proof and that been the end of that story, right? But he did so much more, still related to companionship, but he came back for a little time and showed himself to them to comfort them in their grief and to reassure them that there was more to come so that they could have hope and peace and strength as they spread his gospel. Thomas was not certain that Jesus had risen from the dead and voiced his doubts. Jesus didn't say, oh, well, too bad he doesn't believe that, Thomas, right? Too bad. But he didn't. He was committed to Thomas. So he showed up and he revealed himself in a way that Thomas could believe and understand. Thomas touched Jesus' wounds on his hands and side, and Thomas believed. And then in John 20, 30, it says Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but they are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So since the St. Valentine story didn't really work for me, I'm actually going to take a lesson from Target and jump ahead to St. Patrick's Day. Right? Okay, same pattern. So, because his story actually very much aligns to Jesus' version of love and loving one another. What you may not know about St. Patrick is that he was born in Roman Britain, a province of the Roman Empire. He was captured at age 14 and taken to Ireland as a slave. He's actually not a leprechaun. He escaped at age 20 after God showed him in a dream to escape by going to the coast. Later, he had another dream in which the people of Ireland were calling out to him and saying, "We beg you, holy youth, to come and walk among us once more." So he studied for the priesthood, was ordained as a bishop, and then returned back to Ireland. In my 2,000 years of small groups, it talks about St. Patrick and his model of missionary work. It says, Patrick's model of reaching out to others was highly relational, hospitable, and community-oriented. He and his followers would move into a pagan area and then become part of the community. They took seriously the passage in the book of Psalms that says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Psalm 34, verse 8. Patrick believed that the truth is first caught and then taught. So they tried to make the church accessible to the people. They modeled what they wanted others to follow. They lived life in community, but this was never an end in itself. They never lost sight of giving their community away. In fact, their evangelistic strategy resembled the prayer of Jesus in John 17, where he tells the disciples that the world would know and believe by their unity. Patrick's band of believers talked a lot about love and unity within the Trinity and used the three-sided shamrock to explain the Trinity. They would then demonstrate the love of the Trinity in their communities. The evangelistic bands knew their own lives needed to reflect God's character if they were going to win the unreached Irish. Those who entered the group saw transformed lives, love in action, and how disciples were supposed to act. The seekers were then invited to become Christ's disciples. As a result of this strategy, many received Jesus, new groups multiplied, and missionary bands infiltrated unreached areas. The discipleship and the outreach were intimately connected together. Serve one another, love one another. That's how we demonstrate the love of Christ. So if any of you are interested in joining a small group, there's a card in your pew, and you can put it in the, you can give it to me outside. No? Okay, all right. Well, think about it. Think about it. Christ's love in and through should demonstrate compassion, companionship, and commitment. We see this with our church's trip to Africa, right? There was compassion. We saw a need and felt a genuine calling to do something about it, whether that was pray, go, support those who are going, donate items, or money. There's companionship. Obviously, those who went to Africa are in companionship with those who are there. Those who wrote letters, who have sponsored Neonan children, you wrote letters and sent them over. That's companionship. And then commitment, a commitment to not forget when they come back, and a commitment to continue to support 1040i or the Neonan children who you sponsored. I see other examples here. So many I can't name them all, so don't be offended if I miss what you guys are doing. But even Pop's Marketplace, the whole point of Pop's Marketplace, the little card in the pew, is so that it's designed to create service and fellowship, like our Acts Church, the church in Acts, right? Someone can say, this is what I do. This is my skill set that I can offer. Others can say, these are things I don't need anymore. And somebody can say, this is what I need. And people can respond. We have small groups that serve during Celebrate Recovery. They bring food so that people who come to Celebrate Recovery can eat and have childcare and be able to focus on their time together. Jen's fed my family the last 3 weeks on Wednesday nights. And what's cool, if you come, you can see families all intertwined together, eating together, and sharing that love and that time. Funerals are another. There I go, being all romantic again. Funerals here is an amazing way that the church demonstrates compassion and companionship in a mighty way by providing food, setting up, serving, cleaning up, so that people can celebrate their loved ones. And many times, the people who are doing all that don't even know the person who's passed or the one who's grieving. They just come together to serve. In January, I had a friend lose a loved one, and they had the service here. And I was kind of amazed, because the whole time I'm thinking, this is really interesting, because it's very much like a wedding, right? In that, you book a venue, you invite people, you feed people, you play music or have people sing and do read a poem. You display pictures. There's a program when you walk in. There's flowers. All of those things that you have at a wedding are still usually there at a funeral, and yet you don't have a year to plan it, right? It's this thing that comes together in this very short amount of time. There's no invitations with RSVPs to get an exact head count of how much food to plan for, how many chairs to plan for. And there's virtually no way you can do it yourself. There's no time to meet and give out clipboards, right? There's a lot of trusting that it will come together. And that's this funeral that I was part of in January. That's what happened. I watched it come together. People from throughout their group of friends, people they know, didn't know, brought flowers, and Nancy helped arrange them here so it looked like they'd all gone together in the first place, right? People showed up with plates and a cooler of soda pop and a potato salad and a tray of sandwiches. It just, things kept coming, and I kept setting them out. And then I walked over, and there was way more people than they had expected, which is a blessing. But I thought, I don't know if there's enough food over there, right? So I went over, and the line for the food was just, it kept going, and it kept going, and people kept coming and eating. And I thought, there's no more potato salad. There's not another tray of sandwiches. And then the people were so moved by the willingness of the church to allow them to come that they put a bowl out and said, you know, we want to donate to the church, give what you can. And they just started generously and with smiles and thank yous throwing money into this bowl. And then I looked and there was no more line. Everybody was eating and talking, and there was a little bit of potato salad left. There was a couple of sliced sandwiches. I don't think a caterer who had invitations and RSVPs could have nailed it like that, right? It was the perfect amount of food. And there was so much love in the room. It felt like that church in Acts just coming together and making it happen. And I was so blessed. I got quality time with my Savior. I knew his presence. I got to be part of a modern day feeding of 5,000, right? And I was reminded that Jesus' acts and demonstrations of love are not limited to just what we read in here. That we need to open our eyes and be available to see his compassion, companionship, and commitment in our lives and those around us. Can we say that the same things are happening in our families, out in our community, in our neighborhood, in our workplace, and in our city? This is love. Love stands in the gap. Love casts out fear. Love restores. Love gathers up and binds the brokenhearted. God is love. And anything that isn't of God is earthly and temporary and about as satisfying as a box of conversation hearts, right? They're fun, and I like them. They're fun in the moment, but they're not really meaningful. They're not fulfilling, and I'm not sure they're actually made with anything that's real, right? I don't know. And I like them, but I don't want to miss the experience of real love with the distraction of distorted love. So instead of being consumed with worry or wonder about whether or not we'll have a Valentine, or why we don't yet have a Valentine, or if my Valentine will appreciate my gift, or if my Valentine will give me a worthy gift or just mess it up again, let us be focused on the Creator and Giver of perfect, unconditional love and experience His compassion, recognize his companionship, and rest in his commitment. Well, all is not lost on the Valentine's mood for me. We've heard some poetry, right? And I think we should close in a very cool love song to God. I'll spare you the 17-minute version that I really liked. I'll give you the 4-minute version. Let's throw pebbles at Jesus' window and confess our love to him. Let's stand with a giant boombox over our heads. Thank you for the 80s. Reference, you guys getting it? Okay, thank you. Stand with a giant boombox over our heads and make our love known to him. This is King of My Heart. So I hear we got a little bit of a surprise from Pastor Tim. We have a video, yes? All right, we're going to show a video. See, I can be spontaneous. Well, there we go, loving one another, right? Let's pray. Dear Jesus, may we see your love for us and accept it and enjoy it and give it back to you. And may all that love then overflow to others so that the body of Christ is reminded of your love. and strengthened so that non-believers, those who have not seen you or experienced you, can through us. I pray for the brokenhearted, the hurting, the sick, and the lost, that they would know your comfort and your presence. I pray that you would give us courage and compassion to go out into the world and serve others and love others. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a good day, good week.